Now, with raster data sets, there are a few key attributes or characteristics of them you have to know. One is the cell dimension. The other is the coordinate of the lower left cell. And then also the orientation. Now, typically the orientation of the raster is aligned with our coordinate system so that the cells increase in a linear fashion in a northerly or easterly direction parallel to the lines of our axes for our coordinate system. And then the cell resolution or cell dimension for square cells, there can be other configurations of rasters, but only in theory. In practice, they're always square cells. Have the same dimension in both directions and march in parallel to these x and y directions. Now, in a raster system, we typically don't have this one-to-one relationship between our attribute table and our polygonal or aerial or line features. In vectors, we do have this one-to-one relationship. So again, there's an entry in a table, a row in a table, associated with each of the features, five polygons and five rows. In rasters, we typically don't do this because basically there are too many cells. Now, this is a relatively simple, small raster with only 100 cells. And we could, in theory, have a cell ID for each of these cells, 1, 2, 3, 4, and an entry for it, in this case, the class, and maybe an area with some ID. But typically, rasters are millions or billions or trillions or more cells, and the table would grow without bounds. This table processing is often quite slow. We don't do this one-to-one. There's this many-to-one relationship. So we'll aggregate by a code. All the tens, even if they're disaggregated, get represented by one entry. So each of the individual codes will get represented by an entry in the table. And for continuous data, for real numbers, 1.1 or 2.7, for example, if we had a map of pollution concentration or salinity in a soil or across a measured water body, we wouldn't even have a table often. Or we may have a table that has summary statistics that correspond to the whole area. So the raster data sets have a different tabular structure than vector data sets. And we convert between them. We have to either generate or dissolve or somehow develop these attribute relationships. Now, with rasters, you always have this mixed pixel problem. You have a fixed dimension. In this case, we have two land cover classes, water and land. And in most of the pixels, or many of the pixels, we'll have a combination of both types of features, and so we have to assign a majority. Now, this is for categorical rasters. We have the same kind of problem when we have continuous variables, because it's where we're going to measure the variable. For example, for elevation, we might take the elevation at the center of the cell or the elevation averaged across the cell. But we're representing this piece of geography with one entry. And in this case, this might be called land and this land. Some of them, like this would be water, that are about half land and half water, you know, what do we call it? We don't really know. So it'll get assigned to one or the other, but it's really half or almost half water if we call this land. So we don't get away from the mixed pixel problem. Now, typically, we get around this by making the raster so small that the value for any one raster doesn't matter. But remember, the volume of raster cells goes up with the square of the dimension. So if we cut it in half, we have four times as many cells. So there are limits to how small we can make the cells, both in terms of the data volumes it holds and how we can populate the accuracy, because the accuracy of our assignment declines often with the more cells because we can't visit every cell. This thing called resampling to either expand or reduce the size of the cells will impact the values, and it often muddies the values. There's a basic law or rule of thumb that you want to transform the data as few times as possible from the measurement to the representation. So if you collect data in the field, you want to, as best as you can, preserve that field collected data, its boundaries, its locations, and not muddy it up. And every time you resample, you do that. You'll have to average data if you want to go from a smaller cell to a larger cell. Or if you're going from a larger cell to a smaller cell, you have to interpolate the values in between. So we have to decide how we do that. Do we use the center cell or the most common cell or some weighted average? And just realize in the realization you muddy up the data and you have to be careful about that. So there's often ambiguity. Here I know these are all twos, so I can assign a two here. Especially for categorical data, what do I assign for an output? If this were real data, well, obviously we typically average, but if it's categorical data where these are different categories, what would we assign? And then what do we do with null values? What does null mean? It means missing or just unknown information. For some analyses, I might want to use values. In other analyses, null might mean, no, I don't want to have anything to do with that cell, that there's missing data there, and it makes analysis impossible for that cell. So how you do the reassignment in resampling can vary depending upon your means, and it'll affect the kind of data and analysis that you have coming out of it. The assignment method matters in resampling. Another thing about resampling is the orientation and cell size may differ. So you may have an output cell or point or location that should be influenced more or might be influenced more by one of the input cells. So here, this large cell really overlaps very little with the output cell. So I don't want to do just a simple averaging to get the value. I might want to do a distance-weighted averaging or an area-weighted averaging. So there's different ways, even for continuous data, to get our output values. In the book, we talk about this distance-weighted averaging or a bilinear interpolation. We show a relatively simple algorithm that's basically a distance-weighted algorithm. The further away you are from a location, the less impact it has, and it's linear in the decay. Now, there's lots of different methods. You can go through the example in the book, but basically we're saying, look, the closer you are, the bigger weight you get, and if you're twice as close, you get twice as much weight as a point that's twice as far away, so it's a linear relationship. Now, no decision is final in the kind of data representation we choose. We can convert raster to vector, vector to raster, of course, at some cost. The cost in time, but that's usually the least of our costs. It's more the cost in data integrity that we have to be careful of. And so there are methods where, for example, for the raster cells, you might pick the center point of the cell and then do some sort of smoothing to give you the, rather than stair-step pattern, something that more approximates a real curve or a more natural-looking curve. And the same thing for vector raster. We can basically look at the cells that intersect a line and assign them a value, in this case for this linear feature. Now you can get different polygon shapes or different locations depending upon the algorithm you use, and that's really something that you'll probably get into if you do a lot of that.